Hi, my name is Trey Lawrence. I'm Vice President and General Counsel for the American Association of Orthodontists. And on this episode of the Aligner Insider Podcast, you're going to hear about some potential legal pitfalls that practices are facing in 2023. More importantly, how to work through the process so you can avoid them.
Welcome to another Aligner Insider Podcast.
Well, hello, everybody in podcast land. This is Dean Steinman and Dr. Barry Glaser, and we are the Insiders, and we are back with another awesome podcast for you. And Dr. G, how are you this fine day?
Well, I'll tell you, Dean, I'm stressed. I'm a little stressed.
Okay, what's that?
Well, you know, I consider myself, I'm going to use all these references from movies, so you can pick them all, but I consider myself to be an excellent driver.
I'm an excellent driver.
Yeah, yeah. But I was going to watch Tennessee Wagner, and back then, my sister-in-law was up to visit us with my nephew, backed out of the driveway and like just completely forgot they were there and like took my Jeep, like smashed the whole back. You know, it's like so frustrating, but like I'm really glad, you know, based on, even though I did all that, it's all stress, you gotta go through all that stuff, but you know, thank God I have insurance, you know, and I think
exactly.
That you know, you think about like insurance and you think about like managing risks and stuff like that. You know, it kind of makes me think about what we're going to talk about in this podcast.
Excellent segue, my friend. Excellent segue. And with that said, we have a special guest today. We have Trey Lawrence with us. Trey is a legal expert. We're going to talk today about some legal trends and issues that you must be aware of for your practice in order to keep yourself compliant, to keep yourself on track, and to make sure that you're following all the rules. So, Trey, welcome. How are you today?
I'm great. Thanks for having me. Excited to be with you all.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks so much. So, Trey, tell us about yourself. Who's Trey Lawrence?
Yeah, so Trey Lawrence currently is Vice President and General Counsel for the American Association of Orthodontists. So I have the privilege and the honor in that position of leading both their legal and advocacy teams. So lots of fun stuff that we do on the advocacy side that we won't be talking about today, but representing orthodontists and their patients at the federal level and all across the United States and Canada on lots of different issues. But aside from that, I also manage all of the legal affairs for the association, which includes getting information out to our members on all kinds of legal topics. And that's the kind of thing that we're going to be talking about today. But I have been at the AAO for just under 5 years. Prior to that, I spent almost 20 years in private law practice in a big firm based in St. Louis and some offices in other cities, and doing a range of things, but I primarily have all focused on the litigation side, which that's the piece I really try to bring to the orthodontic world. I think a lot of people are kind of the legal experts in the healthcare world have a lot of transactional experience and can tell you way more than I can about, you know, tax stuff and that kind of thing. But the piece I really try to bring is, having been in the courtroom for 20 years, be able to really paint the picture for practices and doctors about how things play out in court and how juries think, how courts think, those kind of things. Because I think that's really insightful information when you're planning, you know, figuring out what you need to do to really think about what's the worst case scenario. If I end up in court, what's this going to look like? So that's the piece I really try to bring to orthodontist.
Yep. Trey, sorry, Dean, to interrupt, but I just wanted to say before we go further that, you know, I've been an AAO member since day one, and I cannot tell you what a good job I think you're doing, in particular through your social media efforts, to scare the pants off orthodontists, and, you know, maybe in a good way. But I think you have done such a good job of getting messaging out. So much better than anything I've ever seen out of the AAO. And I just wanted to tip my cap to you that it's a job well done. It's very much appreciated by the profession. I think you deliver it sort of in that kind of, you know, snappy, short, like little bites. And I think it's very effective. So I wanted to tell you how much we appreciate your efforts.
Yeah, no, I really appreciate that. And it's certainly a team effort. I'd love to take all the credit for that, but there's I've got a great team here. I mean, they're just all superstars. And I always joke that I have the easiest management job in the world. I just basically have to stay out of their way. But we've been very intentional about a lot of things in the areas that we manage. And and the consumption of information and how changing demographics, I mean, even within the orthodontic profession, changing demographics, I think are really, having a profound impact on the way that people consume information. And so the kind of organizational things that organizations do, the big mass emails and some things like that, you know, we're seeing every organization in the world is struggling. You know, the ADA is going through a major identity crisis right now, launching a new app and trying to figure out more effective ways to communicate. And so social media is one of them. And that's why about 6 months ago, I made the decision we need to get this legal information on social media and launched my The Orth Attorney on Instagram. But I found through that 7-second reels are not always the most conducive format to communicating complex legal matters. A lot of what I do is more just raise awareness about potential issues, and then people can follow up as they need to. But I appreciate your thoughts on all that. That's good to hear the encouragement.
So let's just jump into it. So right now we're in 2023, and there's a lot of things that are constantly changing, you know, and every time you look online or you watch television, you're reading about social media or AI or issues, you know, with privacy and what have you, and how Google and Facebook change their privacy. So, you know, let's talk about, you know, a couple of things that a practice should know about, keep on the radar, and what steps they need to do in order to be compliant and what have you. So let's talk about the two most important things that you think practice should know about as of today.
Yeah. So definitely I'll jump right in on the social media, since you mentioned that one, because obviously social media is just an essential component of any practice's, lifespan these days. And the challenge there is there are just so many potential legal pitfalls out there on social media. So, you know, I'll just kind of shotgun several of them here, you know, responding to online reviews. I mean, online reviews are a crucial, because they're such an essential part of a patient's decision tree, you know, and deciding where they're going to treat is reading reviews. So if you get a bad review from a patient, you want to respond to that. If you get a good review from a patient, you want to acknowledge that. You want to kind of take ownership of that and utilize that. And HIPAA in particular just presents so many challenges. There have been, I've seen several news headlines within the last year of practices that got dinged big time by HHS for HIPAA violations in their responses to those online reviews. I mean, basically, you have to be careful not to say anything factual in the, you know, certainly any disclose any factual information about the patient's protected health information. And even that means even acknowledging that they're a patient, we're a patient at your practice. And so, you know, the bad review, you probably want to dispute everything the patient just said. The good review, you want to say, hey, we love you. You were a great patient. You know, thanks for treating with us. And even both of those responses are going to get into potential problems there.
Well, so what is one thing that somebody could say if somebody still gives you a review and you just want to thank them besides just thank you? Is there anything else that you could say?
Yeah.
Or was that it?
I think in a way it is kind of limited to that, unfortunately. I mean, you'd like to think that the happy patient is not going to turn around and report you for a HIPAA violation, but you can't, you know, certainly in the law, we don't assume anything, and so you can't assume that. So I think there's maybe more ornate ways to say thank you without just saying thank you. You know, you can say things like, thank you so much for that great review. We love to hear great stories like that, or we love to hear happy outcomes like that, or something like that, where really you're not even technically acknowledging that they were a patient. You're just acknowledging the good review itself.
Right.
But, you know, so you can, and you can adapt it to the specific comments by the patient, but I think that's the kind of thing that you say in response to those positive reviews.
And what about the negative? Do you say, you know, we're sorry that you had a bad experience, please contact us at the office to discuss it further, or something along those, or can you not say, please contact us at the office?
I think for the most part you can say please contact us, and that's the kind of thing there. You know, the please contact us I think is important with the negative reviews, because the only thing worse than one really nasty review is if you say something back and then the person comes back, you know, and it turns into a chain of nasty comments. Right. So getting it offline is a key in that situation, and the please contact our office, and we say please contact our office, set up a time to discuss. We're you know, it appears there's been a misunderstanding. Please contact our office to set up a time to discuss. If they do come back with another nasty comment, you just say the same thing again. And I think at that point, other people reading it start to recognize, maybe the person saying the nasty things is not entirely credible because this poor practice is saying, you know, for God's sake, come in and talk to us. And then this person just wants to keep spewing this online. So
maybe it's like for my office, you know, like I'm just a regular guy, just the country orthodontist, this trace. So maybe, you know, we just, you know, we create a Word document with two responses and, you know, thanks. We love to hear great stories like this. Thanks for the great review. Love to hear great stories. Copy, paste, you know, and hopefully you don't have to copy and paste the other one too often, but just have it that, you know, maybe have it, you know, review by my attorney and just copy and paste. And that's it. That's your response to your reviews. And that's the end of it. You train your staff to do that. Would you say that's probably a good strategy?
Yeah, definitely. I take the lawyer hat off and the human side of me recognizes that's not the most emotionally satisfying procedure, but that's definitely the best practice from the legal perspective.
And from my side, from a marketing perspective, I always try to have our clients respond to a review and thank them. And it's funny you mentioned this because this is just an exercise that we have gone through recently, talking to some HIPAA companies to be compliant and what you can and can't say in a review. And your hands are tied. It's remarkable. You got to be so careful, obviously the patient who gives you a good review probably won't say anything, but what if somebody is a lawyer and they see an opportunity, there's a lot of fissures out there
there's a divorce situation, and we see this a lot, mom brings the kids and loves us, but dad hates us because he's the one writing the checks, he's been forced to write the checks. I'm sure you've seen it all, Trey.
Yeah. The plaintiff's attorneys have an almost uncanny ability to find problems almost seemingly don't even exist. And so you've got to manage your own conduct to minimize the opportunity for them to find something like that at every step. And it's the one time, it almost seems like the obvious things are not the ones that come back to bite you. It's the, and I'm saying this from 20 years in court, it's the ones that you really didn't even think were going to turn into a problem that all of a sudden explode on you. So that's exactly the kind of situation you're talking about.
Yeah, great advice.
If you're ready to take your practice to the next level, look no further than Ortho Marketing. Our team of experts is here to help you connect with your target audience and achieve your practice goals through powerful online marketing strategies. With our innovative approach to digital marketing, we help you boost your online visibility and get you real results. From a one-man practice to a large office, we have the resources and experience to create a digital marketing strategy that's tailored to your practice. Don't wait any longer. Let Ortho Marketing help you excel in the digital world. Contact us today and let us start your digital journey together. Orthomarketing.com. And what happens, I know, like, for example, if somebody is not like ADA compliant, there's for every time that you violate, there's a certain dollar amount fined to it. So is there, across the board, something people should be worried about, that every time that you do, cross the HIPAA line, that it's going to cost you this in fines, or are you going to get sued? Like, what's the downside? What's going to happen?
Yeah, that is exactly how many of the kind of statutes that we worry about, especially, unfortunately, with social media, that a lot of the violations are measured on a per violation basis. And so if you're blasting out, Instagram posted 10,000 followers, that can get costly really quickly. So, certainly HIPAA concerns would fall into that. The promotions that practices run, I think, are in particular an instance where violations would be measured on a per instance basis, which would be how many contacts your ad had. So I look at things like state sweepstakes law. So I think many practices, state sweepstakes law is not even on their radar. What they don't realize is that a lot of the promotions that practices do that involve a drawing, that have a prize that has economic value, and that the patient does something for consideration to enter, which consideration is a legal word for does something of economic value to enter. So, if you give our practice a lead or referral, you get entered into a drawing. If you, certainly if you start treatment, everybody that starts in February gets entered into a drawing. Anything that has economic value, and the courts are very expansive on what they believe has economic value, then you may fall under state sweepstakes law. The good news is, if you know about the law, you get a template, it helps you manage that, your terms and conditions, you know the requirements in your state. It's not that hard to comply with state sweepstakes law, but you violate the law, nearly every state calculates the violations on a per, you know, violation basis, and they would conclude if you post something and it's viewed by, you know, 8,000 Instagram followers, and that's going to be 8,000 violations of that state sweepstakes law. No.
All these smokes.
Yeah.
You know, typically we see that all the time. You know, somebody, you know, puts something up there, entered to win, that, you know, even though it says no purchase necessary or this or that, there are small, you know. So ideally, what is the best way to do a sweepstakes? Because, you know, from my eyes, from a marketing social media perspective, we want the practice's patients to be the ones to share the information, to tell everybody how great they are, not the practice itself. So, you know, so obviously you want to get a patient involved and to, you know, share the information, and you can't ask them to like and share and can't do this or that, you know. So really, what's like one tip you could give somebody today if they are thinking of running some sort of sweepstakes promotion that is going to make life easy?
Yeah, I would say talk to a lawyer that knows state sweepstakes law. You can, you should be able pretty easily with Google to find somebody that specializes, because there are people that specialize, you know, among other areas, they will specialize in state sweepstakes law. The AAO itself, we went through that same process, the first drawing type of promotion that the AAO ran. After I had joined the legal team here at the AAO, I contacted a colleague of mine from my previous firm who does sweepstakes law. And it's really easy at that point. They find out some details about what kind of contest you want to run. They give you a template, and right, you can fill in the blanks every time from there. So you can manage, you know, that's really a one-time investment in talking to a lawyer in that situation, and then you can manage it on your own. But just do that the first time. Again, that's one of those, look at it like an insurance policy. Spend a few dollars and then prevent the costly slip up down the road.
And I realistically, who's the whistleblower on something like this? Is it just a lawyer, you know, seeing it? Is it, you know, who would be the person to say, but you're a violation, or that's against the law, or this is how your terms and conditions are not correct? You know, who should be on the lookout for this?
Yeah, so there are a couple of candidates there. Certainly, we talked about the plaintiff's attorneys a minute ago. I think people would be shocked at the level of sophistication that some big plaintiff's class action firms have in scanning the internet for legal violations. I mean, they literally will have paralegals or other personnel that just sit online all day long and go out and look for legal problems. So I think that's one possibility. The other possibility is, I don't want practices to discount the level of activity that some of the federal agencies in particular are out there scanning the environment for potential legal issues. And so I just, one example of that. So paid endorsements, if you compensate somebody to provide a positive testimonial, positive review for your practice, FTC has been really big lately on making sure that that compensation for the endorsement is disclosed somewhere in the advertisement. And the FTC has been very active and proactively going out and looking for violations of that. And that, you know, that again, literally, that's just a matter of scanning the internet, looking for those kind of things. So I think as the AI and the levels of technical sophistication increase for some of these federal or governmental regulators, their ability to scan the internet and look for legal violations is going to increase. And so that's why you really have to operate as if somebody, whether it's a plaintiff's attorney or a government agency, somebody's watching out there, and it's only a matter of time until they run across my, you know, website or my social media.
It's scary. You know, I put up a post for a client a long time ago. We found, you know, some intern who put up a picture they found on Google, and somehow a lawyer contacted us, and this is, you know, their client's picture, and we had no rights to it. And this was seen literally by 12 people on Facebook, 12. And I had to pay $10,000 for this picture to make it go away. And it was an intern. They didn't realize that just go to our stock photo company that we have an account with, and you could do that for free. But, you know, just because, you know, so there are all lawyers out there, and they have this software that scours the web and can find it. And with AI out there now, there's a lot of tools that are in people's backyard, you know, back pockets to use. So, you know, it's real important to understand that. In order for somebody to keep up to snuff with things and to know what's going on, because things are constantly changing. We're talking about two completely different things, from social media to reviews to contest. What's the best way for somebody to become educated and to keep up to snuff. Every time you can just call a lawyer every time you want to do something. So is there like a playbook? Is there some sort of legal checkbook checklist they should go through? What do you recommend?
Yeah, that's a great question, because obviously, I mean, clearly no practice wants to get dinged with some big financial, penalty. And I think most practices really do want to comply with the law. I mean, they want to be law-abiding citizens, but the challenge is that when you talk about the law, it's kind of this amorphous, just this giant thing, and a practice has got enough stuff to worry about during the day. They're like, we can't possibly get our hands around this whole thing and know everything that we need to be complying with in the law. And I mean, I have to confess, even as a lawyer, the law is such a big thing. That's even a challenge for us lawyers. So first of all, take, comfort in that. But even beyond that, you really just have to be systematic and proactive about it. Those are the two things. You need to be systematic, meaning it has to be an intentional effort by your practice to learn what requirements you need to comply with, or there are some areas that you maybe have some exposure in. And then you got to be intentional to do that. And so one of the tools I've served in this role at the AO, one of the things that I recognize is that practices do struggle with, where do we even get started on this? So I put together something called a legal issue inventory that's designed to be a tool to walk practices through the process of how do we figure out what we need to, we don't know what we don't know. So how do we figure out what we don't know? And then what are some areas that we need to look at? And so in that legal issue inventory, what I suggest is the practice take a set period of time, 3 months, 6 months, and just every question that they encounter, they see a legal question on one of the Facebook groups, or they have a problem patient situation or whatever, and just catalog that stuff for 3 or 6 months, then get together a team huddle, go over your list, prioritize, okay, we think this is the number one, we see this one the most often, we see this one the second most often, and prioritize it, make it your checklist of the legal issues because probably every one of those problems you've encountered is a legal issue somewhere. And then do the research that you need to get the answer. And some of it, there are some things that it's just as easy as getting on Google. And I mean, you want to make sure that you're finding reputable sources, but you can Google a lot of stuff. And then for the things that are a little more complicated questions, then actually consult with an attorney around those questions by them. So that legal issue inventory walks people through that process of how to do it. And then I also have a kind of a list of some subject matter areas to look at. So things like patient contracts and informed consent, and just some things to get the thought process started of what are the areas that our practice needs to look at as we go through this process.
So if somebody wanted to get more information, to learn more about it, to get to become, use you as a resource, what's the best way for them to do so, Trey?
Yeah, so certainly we're happy to, for AO members, we're happy to talk with members anytime. We're actually getting ready to kick off a new web portal that will allow members to just go on the member website and type in a legal question that gets shot off to us. And then at some point after that, you'll get back some written information. Wow. So we're always happy to handle it that way. But for orthodontists or anybody else in the dental profession, my social media that I mentioned a little while ago, Instagram's my main landing page. And it's The Orth Attorney, ORTH, and then the word attorney, all one word. But all of the kind of subjects we're talking about today, I cover usually 5 to 6 days a week on Instagram. And a lot of that is really, you can only cover so much legal information in a 7-second reel. So we're not going to exhaust the conversation through social media, but that is really designed primarily just to raise awareness about the problem areas and then encourage practices to look at more into them, more in depth if they need to.
Yeah. And as I said before, don't sell them short, because I follow you on Instagram, and those 7-second reels are, I think, actually more than enough to put my radar up and make me go, another thing I have to write down and deal with. So I think that for me personally, I think they're incredibly effective. So, don't discount them. Trey, are we going to see you? Dean and I are going to be. Dean, you're going to be in Chicago, right?
Correct. Yes.
Well, at the AAO meeting, are you speaking or are any presentations coming up?
Yeah, so I will absolutely be there for the duration of AAO session. So I don't think. It doesn't sound like I'm going to have a speaking engagement on the agenda, but we are going to have two separate booths. are going to have an advocacy and AAO PAC or political action committee booth like we always do. But what I'm really excited about is for the first time in an annual session, we're going to have an AAO legal booth with much of the kind of legal information that we're talking about today as well. So that's a first for us. Going to have Andrew.
That's a great idea.
We're really excited. Going to have Andrew, our associate general counsel, staffing that booth throughout the duration of annual session. So, any of these kind of topics are certainly, we'll have a lot more information about all the resources that the AO has for members and all the forms and the informational articles and all of that.
That's a great idea.
I mean, I said I've been a big supporter of the AAO all these years, and I think it's any organization, it's hard sometimes to overcome inertia. You know, I think it, particularly in medical professions, you know, things tend to stay the way they are. But I'm really pleased to see how the AAO has moved forward to address a lot of the issues that are facing us. The country orthodontists as well as the big practices. So it's nice to see. And I really commend you on your efforts. I think you're on completely on the right track, and it's been very effective. Like I said, it's scary. You know, if your mission statement is to scare the pants off of every orthodontist in North America, you're doing a good job.
I will take that as a compliment. It was intended.
Absolutely. It's well done.
And we have two very important questions to wrap it up, Trey. What's Trey binge watching right now?
You know, that's a great question. And so my standing joke with everybody that I'm friends with is if you start to ask me, if your question to me starts with, have you seen, and then a blank after that, my answer is 99% probably going to be no. Yeah. What I have found over the years, so I started in on Breaking Bad. I know I'm about 10 years late to that party. I started in on Breaking Bad over Christmas break because my kids were home from college and they've already watched through it and they wanted me to watch. Loved it, but I'm just terrible about finishing things out like that.
It's a commitment. It's a commitment, though. That's for sure. It's a commitment for that one, but it's worth it. Yeah.
No, I love it. So yeah, my binge watching tends to fall more in the YouTube category because the little 10 minutes. So food YouTube is always a big one for me.
Okay.
I like to explore different ethnic styles of cooking, and YouTube 10-minute YouTube videos on that fits into my schedule maybe a little better. Nice. So.
All right. So the next important question then is, I just got a text that an asteroid is hitting Earth in 10 hours from now. So what's Trey's last meal?
Oh,
that is a good question. So I would say, I'm going to show my Southern roots here, but I'm going to get in the car and I'm going to drive as far south from St. Louis as I can. And the first barbecue joint that I come to that has a corrugated metal roof and a stack of hickory logs out back behind it. Okay. And I always say with the barbecue joints, the more rundown it looks, the better the barbecue is going to be. So I'm going to drive as far south as I can before the meteor hits and then stop at one of those.
And what are you getting? Brisket, chicken, ribs?
You know, I guess it depends partly on what part of what direction I head. Like if I were to head south more of a Texas direction, I would do brisket and sausage.
Right.
If I went Memphis area, I'd probably do ribs. If I went further east toward the Carolinas, I do the pulled pork. I'm a big fan of all of those.
Oh, so nice.
I just recognizing that each region has got their particular specialty. I'd probably go with whatever area I was in.
Nice. Good answer. All right, Trey. Well, thanks so much for joining us. I really appreciate it. Some great, great insight. We'd love to have you back, again, to keep people educated and to give us more information of trends and what have you. So everybody, please follow Trey. He's at The Orth Attorney. Please follow him for more information. Reach out to him. If you're at the AAO, please, stop by the booth, say hello, and also, get a chance, grab Dr. Glazer and I, tackle us and say hello. We always love to meet our listeners. So everybody in podcast land, thanks so much for listening. Trey, thanks so much for all the insight. Really appreciate it. And Barry, Bourbon Barry, you ready to give somebody one tip today on a new bourbon to try? What do you recommend?
That's an easy one. Go out and get yourself a bottle of Four Roses single barrel. You don't have to get the fancy private selection stuff. Four Roses single barrel, under $50. It's like a party in your mouth. And you don't have to get the Blantons and all that kind of stuff. So that's it. You have that and be happy. And
there you go.
Tell them Barry said you.
Exactly. You know, Barry's, you know, he's no expert, just a regular guy, but he knows his bourbon. So all good. Thanks so much. All right. Go out. If you bourbon drinkers, drink that. If you guys are, you know, in barbecue, he just mentioned a few things that you reach out to Trey. Maybe he'll give you a few tips or some places to go to for some good barbecue. All right, everybody. Thanks so much for listening. Be safe. Happy smiles.